Welcome everybody. My name is Christoph.
I'm this Daniel.
Daniel, my colleague. We are going to tell you a little bit about continuous delivery for machine learning applications with open source tools, and we will explain that what we mean by that in a minute. First of all, we would like to introduce ourselves. My name is Christoph. I'm working at ThoughtWorks for more than 2 years, and I'm the global head for artificial intelligence.
I'm Daniel. I'm a developer or machine learning engineer at ThoughtWorks. I've been working for ThoughtWorks for almost 2 years now also.
Okay, good. So what will you expect in this presentation? We give you a very brief overview of what is ThoughtWorks, so you might be interested in this company, but then we're coming to the topic. We would like to explain you how do we do continuous delivery for machine learning models, and we do this with a concrete example. We have developed a chatbot at ThoughtWorks. If you have been in the machine learning conference in May in Munich, I presented about that chatbot. Today we are looking how we did this in a continuous delivery way. So we will talk to you briefly what have we done with this chatbot, but then what is the problem nowadays? What we observe in a lot of companies, if they build machine learning tools, they do it in an ad hoc way, in a isolated way. For example, data scientists working on their models, then they're giving it to the IT department. They're starting over. They say this is a Python notebook. We cannot really use this for production. So that is an ad hoc and very cumbersome manual process nowadays. What we want to show you how we can use the principles of continuous delivery, which has been developed 10, 15 years ago in the software industry, how can this be used for machine learning applications and make machine learning applications much more faster going to production, much more secure, much more dynamic. So we will show this to you very concrete, this example of the chatbot. So we are telling you our way of working with mixed teams, how to work together in an agile way, and how we have used this continuous working, continuous delivery to set up a continuous delivery workflow for machine learning tools. And we will explain you in detail how this workflow is running, which kind of tools we have used. We only used open source tools, you will see that. So what is our tech stack? How do we do versioning of the different artifacts like the data, the machine learning model, and the code? How do we do quality assurance in all of these steps? How do we bake this into the process so that we have an automatic process with automatic quality gates? And how we bring everything to deployment so that the whole process really can work in hours or even in minutes fully automatically. At the end, we will conclude with a summary, and hopefully we also have some minutes left for your questions and answers. Of course, we are here at the conference for both days, and please feel free to contact us anytime if you want to discuss this with us further. Okay. Just a few words to ThoughtWorks. Maybe some of you know ThoughtWorks. ThoughtWorks is a technology company based in or headquartered in North America, in Chicago, but we are present worldwide. Now we have very strong growth. We have more than 7,000 technologists worldwide, 14 countries, 40 offices. So in Europe, for example, UK, Germany, Spain. In Germany, we are here in Berlin, but I'm from Cologne, but we're also in Hamburg, Munich, Stuttgart. We are doing software development for companies in a very modern software engineering way, in a very agile way. We are technologists. We love technology. And next slide. We are not only working with technology, people from us really driving the field of technology forward. They love to talk about it, but also to write about this. This is just an example of books ThoughtWorkers have written. So really we are very happy to speak and write about it. Some of these books are really standard books. Top left you see continuous delivery. We will talk about this book later. That is the standard work for continuous delivery, and it was written by 2 ThoughtWorkers. What is also important at ThoughtWorks, we not only love technology, we also want to make the world a better place with software. So part of our time, we are investing in social projects, helping people in less developed countries, doing open source software projects, and in providing a lot to the open source community. Last slide, you might know that is the most known publication from us. This is the Technology Radar. It's coming out twice a year, and it gives a great overview what is state of the art in the open source software tool, software space. All our experience in projects with the different frameworks, tools, etc., development environments, we gain in our project, we put into this radar. There's a lot of attention out there with this publication, so you might know it. You find it on our website. It's, of course, free of charge. We are talking about this, so feel free to have a look at that. But now, let's go to continuous delivery and machine learning. So as I said, the use case we want to present you today is a chatbot. We have called it Baloo. It is a chatbot we are using internally, so it's running in production for employees of ThoughtWorks, and it is to do vacation management. So you can use it, you see a little example on the left side, so you can talk to the chatbot and say, I would like to take vacation, how many days do I have left, I want to start on Monday, and I want us to take vacation until Friday. He can knows of course about public holidays, he can calculate the days, he can tell you how many days you have left, how many days this will take, you can take vacation, you can cancel vacations, get the status. He's also doing the workflow, for example, have you checked with your team or your supervisor, this kind of stuff. So that is running. What is more important was it was kind of a use case, a proof of concept for us, for ThoughtWorks, to really see how far the technology is developed. So we developed this with our core principles in mind, of course, like continuous delivery, agile, DevOps, so operations and development is working hand in hand, and a user-oriented product design. And we used state-of-the-art technology. It's running on Heroku. We used Rasa. You might know this is here from Berlin. It's a really state-of-the-art framework for chatbot development based on neural networks, using Python, TensorFlow, Keras, LSTMs in the background. The interface, the front end is Google Chat. And we also use CircleCI. Later you will see the tech stack in more detail. Yeah, and this is an overview how the chatbot is working, just to give you an overview how here this Rasa platform in our chatbot is working. So you see on the left side here, this is the user. He's using the Google Chat platform. And for example, here's the question, how many days of vacation do I have left this year? He puts this text into the chat as a message. It goes to the chat platform. The first block is an intent classifier. He tries to figure out what is the intent of the user based on the sentence. This is done with a deep learning network. And so here in this case, the intent would be annual leave left. How many days have I left? The name is annual leave left. This intent now is going to the named entity recognition because you have variables. For example, when do you start vacation, end vacation? These are named entities. They have to be filled with information. In this case, it's very simple because this is an example from last year. We have been in year 2018. How many days left in this year? Of course, start and end time would be 1st of January. Start of the year and 31st December is end of the year. So these named entities are filled. Then this information goes to the dialog model. The dialog model decides on the status. Is there information missing? What would be my next action? Could be that the chatbot is asking for more information, for example, to clarify things or just to say goodbye, end the dialogue. In this case here, the dialog model finds out, okay, this is a request for the days left, so I have to go to an external system to get this information. So I have to predict action, get annual leave left. This goes to the action resolver, who is doing the action, for example, producing a new question, or in this case, with an API asking the external system, so for this user, how many days he has left. Yeah, this is an HR system, and the HR system gives the answer, it's 12 days left. This goes then from the action resolver in the natural language generator. He generates a natural sentence about this. For example, you have 12 days left. And this sentence then goes back to the chat form, and the chatbot has answered this. Yeah, so this is the general flow, how a chatbot works in general, and how we have done that. But as I said, this talk is not about the chatbot now. We want to show you how to do this development in a company in a very professional way, state-of-the-art software development with continuous delivery. And let us step one step back and forget the chatbots. Look how machine learning applications are developed and used in companies, in organizations. And if you see it on a very high angle, so the, if you really look at the big picture of an organization, you see that information is flowing through this in, through this organization. And this is true for all organizations. And this is what we call the continuous circle of intelligence. And it starts with one. So a company who wants to do something with data, or wants to become, or is a data-driven organization, or even an AI-driven organization, first of all, this organization has to acquire data. So for example, the organization wants to do a recommender system on their website. First of all, they need the information about the products, about the behavior of the user, the buying behavior of their customers, and so lots of data. And this is what companies actually are doing. They are acquiring all and collecting all the data they can get. Data from their customers, data from the market, data from production, whatever data is available. So this data usually is saved in a kind of a data lake, a data storage, and it's there. But this is raw data. These are basically zero and ones. So nobody really knows what is in there. Yeah. So it has not yet a meaning, or it has no no information really. So that would be the next step: getting out of the data some really valued information. And this is what you have to do. You have to store the data, you have to clean the data, you have to featureize the data, calculate the data, calculate features. Yeah. For example, if you have a timestamp from your website, this is maybe a timestamp in bits, and you cannot really read it, but you can calculate the day of the time, the weekday, and this is valuable information for you, yeah, which you or an algorithm really can use. And this would be the step going from data to information. And now information is something you didn't know before. This is really a value for you or for an algorithm. But this is not yet enough. So you know this, but the next step would be that you model the data. And modeling data means you calculate or you define a mathematical model of the data, how the data is behaving, or how the reality behind the data, the reality who is producing the data, is behaving. So how is your customer behaving? What is his buying behavior? What is he going to buy? And if you are familiar with machine learning, there are plenty of mathematical models to do this, to train these models based on the data, and then this model has the same behavior, more or less, depends on the quality, as your reality, for example, as the customer who is buying something. And this is, of course, very important, because now you can predict the behavior of something, of the outer world, like a customer. And this model then, but you're not done yet, so this can be done in a Python notebook, right? That is what data scientists are doing. But you don't have it in production yet. That is, again, a totally different story. You have to use this model now to put it into the IT, to influence and change your IT processes. For example, what you show the customer on the website, what you recommend, or the articles you are ordering based on the demand of the customer demand you have forecasted, this kind of stuff. So you have to bring the model into the IT, productive IT system. You productionize it. Now you have questions like how to scale this, how can hundreds or thousands or even millions of users use this, how to integrate it in my overall processes. So totally different questions, usually done by the IT department. At the end, you execute these algorithms, yeah, so that now your algorithm is working. You do some recommendations, the customer changes his buying behavior based on these recommendations. And of course, now this is influencing the real world. So the customer is doing now, changing his buying behavior maybe based on this recommendation. And this again generates new data, new external data, which you have to feed in again into your circle here, and this is because it's a circle, that is the close of the loop, and this new data of this, for example, buying behavior, again influences your circle and your model, you retrain your model, you change it again, and you see that you have this kind of circle. And this is in almost every organization, company who is doing this stuff, this is this kind of circle. But in most of the organizations, this is a very cumbersome and slow process. If you can go one back, sorry, not yet. It's a very slow process. It's a manual process. It's an ad hoc process. You have a lot of friction. So this is our manual steps. For example, you are a data scientist here, and you want to have this data. You have to discuss and with the business, can I get this data? And they say, oh, this is really a secret. And there, do you have the authorization? We have to anonymize this. We have to make a contract and all this kind of stuff. So this already can take weeks, months, even longer. Then the data scientist is doing this model for weeks, for months in a Python notebook. He has great results. Then he goes to IT and says, can you please make this, make an API, integrate this? And this, again, can take months before they build it. So we see companies, the whole circle can take easily 1 or 2 years. Yeah, but if you think of recommendation, of dynamic pricing, all this stuff, you need this immediately. You need this continuously. And we will show you techniques how to do this in hours, in minutes even, fully automatically. Now the next slide. So that is what we see in the industry, actually, when we talk to our customers, most of them. That, for example, data scientists generate this nice data on data, modeling it, but they are kind of throwing it over the fence. Say, here, IT department, I have this model. It works perfectly on my CSV files, has a great recognition rate. Can you integrate it now into your IT environment? Yeah. So throwing it over. And the IT department says, oh, this is a Python notebook. I have no idea how to productionize a Python notebook. And actually, it's not really code. It's not tested. It's not test-driven development. It doesn't has, it's not object-oriented. It has not the function. So maybe they even rewrite it completely. Or they say, we cannot use Python. We need it in Java. So they rewrite it in Java. Or they have to containerize it, whatever they have to do. But usually, there's a big, big fence and a break between the data science department, which often belongs to business, or the data analytics department, and the IT department. How should the teams work together? We see that these people are working in isolation. Yeah, data scientists work for their own, maybe with the business. IT developers working on their own. Data engineers, again, working on their own, providing the data, but do not really know what is the business value of this data. Yeah, we have different roles in different silos. When you work with data, you have much more complexity than with normal software. Yeah? Already, this is a problem when you write normal code. Yeah, that, for example, you have a developer and he throws this over the fence to the ops people, the operations people. With data, it's even more complicated because you have at least three dimensions of artifacts, of things you have to take in mind. You have the code of your application, you have the model you are training with their parameters and weights, and you have the data. Yeah, and data can be huge. Also, the model can be huge, so big data. And you have to take this together. You have to keep this synchronized, versioned, and this is a much higher complexity if you are just looking for the code. So orchestrating all of this is complex and hard. Reproducible outcomes is difficult, and also quality assurance is much more complicated. Next slide. Yeah, here you see again these three important artifacts you have to take into account if you're working with machine learning. You have the data, of course, you have the data features, the schema, the volume of the data. You have your model, you have hyperparameters, you have the weights, the trained model, and also the code of the data, yeah, or the framework. The code of the model, and the framework of the model. And last but not least, you have some code for your application. You have APIs, you have the application around it, around your model. There, portability, scalability, and maintainability of this code is really important. So how do we do this? And if you are in software engineering, you're probably familiar or know the concept of continuous delivery. That was developed 10, 15 years ago. The problem at that time was that there was huge upgrades, so people were collecting what they want to change in the software. There was a waterfall model to design and create software. So there was a big specification of a next release. Then the developers were working for months on this, to developing this. Then it was tested. And then there was the big day when there was the update or the upgrade of the software or a release of a new software, so maybe once a year. And of course, that was was very painful, cumbersome. It was, the business didn't like it because they had to wait so long for features. It was error prone. People were working the whole night on this upgrade, and always, of course, every time something went wrong. So then this stuff was invented to say, let's do it in a different way. This should not be like that. Let's have little chunks, test it immediately, bring little things directly to the production system and not wait half a year or a year. And the little things, the risk is lower. It's much easier to check the quality, make quality assurance, and it's much easier to automate everything. And that is the idea behind continuous delivery. So it is a mindset, first of all, to bring people together, to bring roles together. Yeah? For example, DevOps is coming from here. So that developers and operational people working in one team, and not the developer says, I'm done, I did my unit test, so here, operations, that now it's your job. Yeah? So working in one team, it's really important. Improve production models continuously, little steps, every day, several times a day. Create a repeatable, reliable process. When you do things several times, automate it, and don't do it manually. Build quality in. Wherever possible, build quality checks automatically. Check it as soon as possible. Don't wait until everything is in the release and you test with your customers. Done means released. Done is not meaning I'm a developer, I've written the code, I make my unit test, everything is green, so I'm done. That is not what it means. Done is when it is out at the customer, only then. always ready to go to production, very important point. So if you work with these principles, you always can hit the button and say, okay, I can release the software whenever the business wants it, when the business is ready. So it is now a business decision and not a technical decision when you bring code into production. Big, big difference. And when we use these principles for machine learning, so what we get out of here along these three dimensions is we get a really increased speed, much faster process. We are not talking any longer about years or months, but maybe days or hours. Increased quality, because quality is in the process, and a decreased complexity. And now we want to show you in more detail how we did this. And I give over to Daniel.
Hey. So yeah, as Christoph already mentioned, what continuous delivery is really about is more of this mindset of how you deliver software. And what we like to do is we don't deliver just like a technical thing, but we like to create products for users. So every time we create something, it's like a product that fulfills a need for users. So the user is really in the spotlight here. So in this process to accomplish this, we need to have a cross-functional team. So because there's so many requirements from the business, from the user's perspective, from the technical perspective, it is really important to gather all these requirements in non-silos, so like together in a team, and to really dig down what is it that we need to do and why do we need to do it and what should happen to make this work in production. So you start off in each of those processes, you have multiple people working together on those steps. So the sole process starts off with an ideation phase, where most of the time a data scientist, a product owner, and a business analyst sit together and they think about how can we, if there's already a product existing, how can we improve the product? Or if you are at the start of a product, you can think about, hey, what is it actually that we need to create for the users? What would bring the most value to the business? So those people then sit together and think about what should happen from the technical side and also from the business side. They formulate some sort of idea, which then goes into an exploration phase, where most of the time the data scientist and a dev, for example, can look together in this idea and see, hey, is this even feasible? So this could be, for example, in our use case with the chatbot, you could think about, hey, we want to enable a new skill in the chatbot that people can ask when it's the next public holiday, for example. So then those two people, they sit together and they think about what should happen to make this work from the model side and the data side and also from the technical side. And most of the time, one artifact that could come out of this is, as mentioned before, a Jupyter Notebook, where you play around with the data and you try to find is there some sort of value in this solution and would this work? At the end of this exploration phase, what usually happens is then you sit together with a data scientist, a developer, and a BA, and you think about how can we pour this functionality or this new feature request into an hypothesis or user story. So if you have, for example, something that you're not very sure of, there's like a hypothesis. For example, if we add a new feature into our system, our recommendation will be better by like 50% or something. So that's more like a hypothesis that you can create. Or if it's something like if we give users the possibility to ask for public holidays, then we can increase the usage of our system. So this would be, for example, also a hypothesis. But you could also write traditional user stories. So all of these stories and hypotheses go then into the backlog, where they get refined, so they can be really kind of worked on from a more higher level. And then after they are in the backlog, the team and the PO decide together what is my highest priority and what do I want to accomplish in the next iteration. So you take all those things into an iteration planning, you sometimes estimate it, and then you pick your prioritized choice of what are the things that I want to do in my next iteration. And when you put then those stories and hypotheses in your iteration, you look over them together with your BA, and then you refine them to make them really workable. So then after that, you have a list of stories that you can start, which we usually do in a story kickoff. So in the story kickoff, all the people that have opinions about the story or that have worked on the story, like the data scientist, the QA, a BA, and the devs, they sit together and say, hey, what is the story about and what should we actually do in the story? Then the dev pairs take over, they implement the story, they test it on dev, they continuously deploy on dev, they fix some bugs if they find them on the story. And then after they're done with all of this, they call for a desk check, where all those people that were also in the story kickoff come together again, and then they look if the story that you implemented is really what you wanted to have at the beginning. And this you do not for the whole system, but you do it for each story. So after each story is done, you have much shorter feedback cycles, where you check, is this really the thing that was wanted in the beginning? And after everybody looks over it, and it is then again checked by a QA after the desk check, you can deploy it to your multiple environments, for example, on a staging environment to test it manually or exploratory, and then you can deploy it to your prod environment. And this whole process, it depends, of course, on the hypothesis or the user story, but most of the time, this is like a thing that takes 2 days on roughly. So as we saw before, this was more of a things about weeks, but now we've really shortened it down to a much faster feedback cycle and smaller loops. And to accomplish this, you need, as mentioned before, you need some sort of automation which make this manual processes in an automated way, so it's faster and more reliable and also easier for you. So this is how continuous delivery for machine learning can look like. This is actually the pipeline that we have for our chatbot. So all these steps are dependent on the product that you want to build. So this is specifically for the chatbot. And you see here on the beginning, on the left side, you can see the three artifacts that Christoph was talking about before. So we have our source code, our data sets, and our model. And each of those artifacts trigger the pipeline. And we will now run through the pipeline. So if any of those three things on the left change, for example, now the source code, we trigger the pipeline run automatically. And the pipeline starts off with automatic tests for the code. So these are your standard testing pyramid tests. So you have your unit tests, integration tests. What we also had for our use case was a security check, because we deal with data that user put in. So we wanted to make sure this is very secure. And each of those things are automated. And they basically have a threshold where they say they are green or they're red. So to continue on, all of these checks have to be green. And if all of them pass, we load our latest model that we can find from our data lake. And with that latest model, we then run end-to-end test. So again, we had this chatbot. And what the chatbot should do, it should answer questions from users when they type it in. So we automated like two or three end-to-end tests. where we say we have this fixed input and we want the chatbot to return this result. So every time I ask, for example, or I say hi, the chatbot should reply hi. It's just a very easy example. But in our use case, we had a fixed set of a user which typed in how many vacation days do I have left. And then we expected for the user to return from the system a fixed number of that and that many vacation days. So this way we can ensure that the base functionality of the system still works after we change the source code. Afterwards, after each change of the source code, we re-evaluate the model. So if we change anything in the code, did it impact our model and our metrics of the model? So we looked here at your standard model metrics like precision, recall, accuracy, and this check actually tries to make sure that the model always at least improves. So it's also fine if the model still works the same way, but it should never be less than it was before. So after this was done, up until this step, everything ran automatically, and it also deployed the thing on development automatically to see are my integrations still working on development and did some other changes break anything or not. And then the next step would be to deploy this on staging, which also happens automatically. So staging we used for exploratory testing. So we had a staging bot that we had in Google Chat, which had a staging flag in the name of it. And then we could use it to actually write with the bot and see if what we wanted to do with the bot was still working. This really helped us in finding out some bugs, for example, if other APIs changed or if some, we also had some issues with Google, like logging in into your account and stuff. So this really helped us to find those things before we went into production. After you are done with your test on staging, you actually deploy this manually now to production. So we added a manual step to deploy to production. So there's just like a button that you click to deploy it. And we had this in place so we could monitor when we deploy what actually happens to our model. And so now we will look into what happens when you actually change the data sets. So that we had two data sets, one data sets with conversations of how conversations look like, what are conversational flow, so like what action comes after another, when you say hi to the bot, what should return. And we also had a second data set which was used for the intent recognition. So we had example sentences for intents like greeting or saying goodbye, all this stuff. And for both of these data sets, we had two automatic checks in place. We first checked if there are any duplicates in the data sets. And we checked the distribution of all the features and their values over the data sets. So this was basically done to check the data integrity, if all the data in itself is good, and also to check if we have unbalanced data sets. So the thing is, when you have unbalanced data sets, what you tend to do is you create a bias towards certain values that you see. And we wanted to get rid of those biases to have a very generalized model. And those checks were all automatic and also had a threshold. So we wanted to have, we at the end had a number to check the distribution, that the distribution for each feature should not be over, like, I think it was 0.01 or something. And after all those checks pass, you again use these new data sets to train the model. And then what you do is you version the trained model that you just created with its data sets, and you persist it, for example, on a data lake. And from here, as you saw before, this load latest model thing, this is where the model is loaded into the pipeline and also later on in the production systems. After this model was versioned, we again check it in an end-to-end test. So we load the model from the data lake. We check if our system is still using in its basic behavior. And then afterwards, we check if the improvements that we tried to make in the data sets before, that's why we changed them, if they actually impacted the metrics of the model. So sometimes, for example, when you think about, oh, it would make more sense if I add more data, what we found out sometimes, if we add like more data that is of less quality, the metrics kind of dropped. So this is also a great way of optimizing this whole process and making sure that not a bad model makes it into production. So afterwards, you again, like before, you deploy to staging and production. So if you change the model, which is much more delicate, we used in our use case neural nets. So you could change things like the cost function, the number of layers, number of neurons in each layer. So all of these things, they're kind of like you're experimenting with the data. So you have maybe some assumptions, like if I add more layers, it might get better. But there's no deterministic proof that you know beforehand that, hey, if I add this, this is totally going to work out. So after we change each model, this becomes actually more important. We had this automated process still in place to train the model, to version it, and now we combine it with the source code to actually see, hey, is my basic behavior still working? So this really is an important step when you mess with the model, because you don't really know what comes out of your experiments. So it might be that you break the base functionalities. And after this like minor basic test step is green, you also want to know how much you improved, if you improved. So what we also added in all of this is to have some observability. So the metrics that we actually produce in this step, we send to a service to actually monitor each metric after each deployment or after each run and see what actually improved the system. So over time, you could see the flow of the metrics and how they evolved. And you could actually see which changes led to which change in the metrics. So you could really see what really works when I change it, and you can reproduce these changes. Yeah, and then the deploying and staging is still the same like before. So all of this really helps you to have this automation and have this faster delivery. So when you have this automated, you don't have to do this manually. You have less complexity because it is automated, and deploying to production, for example, is easy as just like hitting a button. So with these checks in place, it is really easy and fast to deliver something. And to actually, in this whole process that we looked at right now, we have all these kind of tools. So we need discoverable and accessible data. We need to load the data on different places. We need to run it through tests and all this stuff. We need to version control the data and the artifacts. As we saw, we have three kind of artifacts. All of these need to be versioned so we can see which changes of them led to which result. And we need some sort of orchestration to continuously deliver this into our production systems. And of course, we need the infrastructure to actually support this. So we need to deploy services that in our landscape represent our actual product. So these services need to be deployed on multiple environments where we test them and where we deliver them to our customers. And in all this process, you also want to have some observability. So you want to check if your model is doing better, and if it is doing better, why it is doing better, and what is really effective here. And we also want to do some monitoring observability on business metrics, for example. So you want to see in the end, you want to see how you impact the customers, how you impact the users. So how many users are actually using it, for example, or how many questions are we actually answering, and how many API calls are we, for example, doing to fulfill this. And all of this we accomplished with different sets of tools. So for discoverable and accessible data, we just use S3 buckets, which represented our sort of like low cost data lake. So the data was easily accessible, we could easily manage it, and we could store it in the cloud, and it was pretty cheap. So this was like our thing that we used for this. And to version the code and the artifacts that we create, we used a combination of GitHub and DVC. So DVC is a versioning tool for data and models. I will come back to this one later. And for the continuous delivery orchestration, we use CircleCI. So CircleCI was our main tool to create our pipeline and to orchestrate the whole process and to automate it. and our infrastructure for multiple environments. So we used Python services, we used Python to actually train our models, we used Python to create a normalized version of our features, of our data sets. And then we actually also used Rasa, which is a Python framework, to more easily create this chatbot. And then for model performance assessment, we had Grafana dashboards. So on those dashboards, we could see how our model metrics are doing. We could see our technical metrics, for example, of our production service, if everything is up and running. And for our monitoring and observability, we used ChatBase, which is like an analytics platform for chatbots. So you send to ChatBase all the messages that you create in your system anonymized, and then you can see the flow of the users in their conversations, and you can see where the bounce rates are, or where users stop the whole conversation. You can see the usage of the bot, you can see where the intents that you try to recognize were not really recognized, and you can really dig into how the users are using this tool and if it is serving their needs. So one of the spots, well, like we have those three things that we would like to highlight, which is the versioning. And the versioning is, just as the word already says, is very similar to how you version code. So for the code, we used GitHub. But for the model and the data sets, we used DVC. DVC is a tool, a standalone tool, that actually creates those kind of files you can see on the right. This is like a manifest file. So in this file, you have a command that produces an output that you can see here on the bottom. And then you can also specify what this command is dependent on. So here, for example, we see that we have this training command. It creates some sort of pickle file of embedding layers of our model. And we are dependent on the actual script that creates or that trains the data. And we are dependent on config. And later on, we are also dependent on the input data, the data sets. And on all of these steps, you see MD5 hashes. So if any of those things change, the command would need to run again. So that's how we actually track the versions. So the version of one artifact is dependent on all the dependencies that the artifact has to create it, which is one, the code that executes to create the artifact, and dependencies that you have to put into the code to create the artifact. So this file is actually then put into Git. So if you have this file present and you you do DVC run, then DVC checks if any of these changes. If it didn't change, nothing will happen. If one of those changes of the inputs, of the dependencies, then it will run the command and produce a new output and put the MD5 hash of the output in this file, which is then versioned with Git. So you have the whole workflow of how your artifacts are created under your control and versioned in Git. Mm-hmm. So as we saw before in the diagram, each change to the code, the model, or the data that we have triggers a rerun of the pipeline. And then with each triggering of the pipeline, we also have these automatic quality checks that really make sure that we don't, in this whole automated process, deliver something that is not working. These quality assurance gateways actually represent your standard testing pyramid. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but what the testing pyramid actually says is that at the bottom are things that are very cheap that you should do the most of. At the top are things that are very expensive, so you should do less of. So for your normal code, you have at the bottom unit tests that are very cheap to produce. They run really fast, they're very reliable, so you should create the most unit tests as possible. So you check or you test your code in smaller units in an isolated fashion. And then the thing up top over the unit tests are the integration tests, which are actually saying you should test less of integrating different components in your software. So you should do less integration tests and more unit tests, for example. And if we go all the way to the top of the pyramid, we see exploratory tests. So these tests are actually done manually, and they're very expensive because you have to run through them. You could also automate this, but the cost of automating it often is also very high. So actually, the exploratory testing you should do the least of. And what we also added in this pyramid to the standard pyramid are things that are necessarily or that need to happen to actually create a continuous delivery pipeline for machine learning products. So what you also have to do additionally on top of this is you have to check your data integrity and your model performance. So in this process, you saw before that we are doing some checks that relate to the data and the model. So these checks are also things that you have to do, but you shouldn't do too much of it because they can also be very expensive and take a lot of time. So for the data sets, we created histograms that check the distribution. We added standard deviation, which we use to check if we don't have any anomalies, and we did null checks and duplication checks. And for the model performance tests, we just created the normal model metrics and evaluated these. So after you make sure that this is already in the process and you get this kind of for free because it runs automatically, you also try to automate the whole deployment process. So if you want to deploy code normally, you ship it in containers most of the time, and then it runs in some sort of environment in those containers, and it is served to your customers. The specification that you have to add now is that in this whole process, we said that we persist and store version models on a data lake. So this data lake becomes your main infrastructure where you want to serve your models from. So when you start up a container, you have your software in here. In here we have the chatbot, which contains a lineage manifest, which was the DVC file that you saw, in which we see which kind of data we need and what the model is that you want to store. So with this manifest file, we load our trained model from the data lake, which is the correct one for this change that we did. So for this commit and the push, we're deploying a special set of the version of the code, a version of the data set, the version of the trained model that we're using. With this in mind, we get the data from the data lake and deploy it on each environment. So this is also done automatically, so you don't have to mess with this. So it's much easier to deal with, and it's very fast in this way. When you have then this model in place with the service, which here is now the chatbot, you can see when you deploy this what this is actually doing to your business. So when people are using this and chatting with it, you can see how this model that you created is actually influencing your real life business. So when people use it, how well is it working now? Is it working better than the version that you just deployed before? And is the hypothesis that you had in the beginning really, really true? So you can evaluate, for example, in A/B tests, what you stated before. So if I add this public holiday feature that I talked about before, is the bot really used more, and is it adding any value to your users, which you want to have? And all of this can now be done in this automatic way, in a reproducible way, and much faster. So what you can then do is, after you have this deployed, you run your checks, you run your tests, you do your A/B testing maybe, you can see what are the next steps to actually optimize this model. So you can further improve it and make it an even better product.
So last slide, a little bit over time to wrap that up. So just as a summary, what we have shown you is with this workflow, with this environment, really, first of all, cross-functional teams can work together. Data scientists, data engineers, developers, business analysts, and they have the same platform and the same processes to do this work. Yeah. So it's no throwing over the fence, giving it to the next one. You have a common infrastructure and processes to do that. We showed you that you really can fully automate, mostly automate the process. Really, you can push automation very, very high here with automatic quality gates, etc. And by this, you bake in quality into the process. Yeah, quality is no longer that you have to do it manually, maybe you forget it, or you spend more time or less time. It's in the process, and it's not moving forward until certain quality gates are met. You get a much faster turnover. Now it's really a question of hours or minutes and no longer weeks, months, or even years until you move forward in your development pipeline. And we showed you how to synchronize the different versionings of the different artifacts. So the data, the model, and the code. And this helps you to have consistency from the first development to the production. At every time step, you know what belongs together. You can stop, you can go backwards in time to the former version if you screw up things. This is every time consistent and repeatable. So you can reproduce your results. For example, if somebody of your data scientists getting ill, not coming to the office, the other one can take over. You're not losing that information, and you always can go back to earlier releases. That's really important. And what we have shown you, this all can be achieved and done by open source tools. This is just one selection. Of course, there are plenty of other tools out there, but this is totally doable. Okay, so we are done. Thank you very much for your attention.